If you recall, in the last lecture, we were discussing about the ARM instructions with which you can do some arithmetic and logic operations. Now, in this lecture, we shall be further looking into instructions which allow you to transfer data between registers and memory. So, the title of this lecture is ARM instruction set, the second part. Now, in this lecture, as I said, we shall be primarily talking about the data transfer instructions, mainly between register and memory, and you will see that there are instructions which can transfer a single register value and also multiple register value. And we shall at the end talk something about this input output operations in ARM, which supports something called memory mapped I/O. This is also something we shall be briefly talking about at the end. So, let us look at the data transfer instructions that are supported by the ARM architecture. Broadly, there are three types of data transfer which are allowed. Well, here we are mainly talking about registers and we are talking about memory. So, transfer between registers and memory. So, you can have single register load and store. Like from memory, you can load the value into a single register, that is a load instruction. Store means from a register, you write that result into some memory location, that is store. So, there is a single register variant, one value is loaded or stored, or you can have an option where multiple registers can be loaded and stored. Like you can say that not one, four registers will be loaded, or let us say four registers will be written into memory one after the other. So, you can specify that in the same instruction, in a single instruction. Okay? And also there is a very special kind of instruction where a register memory swap operation is allowed. Swap means exchanging the value of a register and a memory in a single instruction. Now, this kind of instructions are very useful, not in the normal scenario, primarily by the operating system. It is used by the operating system mainly for implementing several different kind of locks. There is a very commonly used lock which is used, this is called semaphores, and these kind of register memory swap instructions are very much useful to implement these semaphores. Okay? But for normal application development, we do not require to use this kind of instructions. Okay? So, the other instructions are sufficient. Okay. Well, the first thing to note is that in ARM, the data transfer instructions that we are talking about, they use register indirect addressing, that you must use some register to point to memory location, and via that register you are doing load and store. So, what I mean, an example is shown here. Before you can access memory, load and store, you will have to initialize some register with the address of a memory location. So, there is an instruction ADRL, address register load. Here you specify some register, let us say R1, and you specify some memory location, let us say table. Well, in assembly language, you do not specify the absolute address, you specify some label with respect to the data, let us say table. So, what will happen? The memory address corresponding to this data item table, that memory address will be loaded in R1. But once you have done this, you can use this load register and store register instructions, LDR STR. LDR R0 within square bracket R1 means memory location whose address is in R1 will be transferred to R0. In store, just the reverse, memory location whose address is in R1 will get the value from R0. This is store. Okay? So, this kind of load and store operations are supported. Now, this is what we call single register load and store. So, we are loading and storing one register at a time, right? Like in the example that we have just now shown, this value of R0 was being stored in memory, this, or this memory location was being loaded into register R0. So, one register transfer at a time by an instruction. Now, as I said, ARM supports various other options, multiple register we shall come a little later, but before that, well, even in single register load and store, there are various options we can have. First option is, well, this is simple register indirect. Okay? Now, we can have register indirect with offset. Like we can also specify an offset value with respect to the current instruction, where this offset is limited to 4 kilobytes, because in the instruction the space that is provided is 12 bits, and in 12 bits you can specify 2 to the power 14 or 4 kilobytes of offset. Now, in the instruction, how do you specify that? You specify it like this. Earlier, within the square bracket, you are specifying only the register. Now, you are specifying also some immediate data like this, R1, #4. What does this mean? The value of this register is added to this offset, and then memory location corresponding to that address, that value is loaded into the register. Similarly, for store, if I write like this, then R1 will be added to 12 like this. This will give you the memory address, and R0 will be stored into that memory address, right. So, not only a register indirect, I can also specify an offset which will be added to that register to generate the final memory address from where loading and storing can be done. Okay? There is a third option also available. Well, you can have auto indexing, well, in addition to using register indirect with offset. Well, auto indexing means there are many applications where you want to load or store data one by one consecutively from a block of memory locations. So, there in these instructions, what happens? This register, which was pointing to some memory location, this automatically gets incremented after one transfer is done. And how do I specify this? I specify this by this exclamation symbol. This indicates auto indexing. Okay? And the meaning is that in the earlier case, you see we are doing this, right? So, here we are doing this all right, but after this we are also increasing the value of R1 by 4. And here we are doing this, and after that we are increasing the value of R1 by 4. This value is getting incremented by 4, because every memory word is 32 bits, which means 4 memory addresses. That is why the address is incremented by 4, so that next time when you come, this R1 is pointing to the next memory location, next word, right. There is another variation also, this is called post indexing, where after this square bracket you specify the R1, you give a comma, and this hash value you give after that. Here meaning is slightly different, you see. This means you first load the value as usual, and then increase R1 not by 4 always, but whatever offset you have given here. If you give #4, it will be incremented by 4. If you give #12, it will be incremented by 12. This is the main difference. Okay? Sometimes you may need to increase the register by some other value than 12, you can use this variation of the instruction in those cases. Okay, and the other thing is that whatever we have discussed so far, we are assuming that the entire 32 bit word is being transferred. But there are many applications where you really do not need entire 32 bit of data. 8 bits or 16 bits of data may be sufficient. These are called byte or half word. There are some various, you can say, categories of instruction load and store which work with byte and half word. Byte is indicated by B and half word is indicated by SH. You see, load register byte, store register byte, load register half word, store register half word. So, the way you specify registers is the same. The meaning is that for byte thing, only 8 bits of data are transferred from memory. That means, only one byte is loaded or stored, not the whole 32 bits. Similarly, for half word, 2 bytes are transferred, 16 bits are transferred. Okay? So, it depends on whether you are using byte, half word or normal word. It will depend how many bytes will be loaded or stored. It can be 1 byte, 2 bytes or 4 bytes. All right. Okay. Now, let us come to multiple register load store variety. This is interesting. Here we are saying that in ARM instruction set, there are facilities to transfer data between several registers and memory. Now, one thing you recall, we also mentioned earlier when you were talking about this ARM and RISC architecture, these are some facilities where ARM is deviating from RISC architectures. Because one philosophy of RISC architecture was that all instructions should be of equal size, they should be very simple, they should be able to execute in a single cycle. But when you are transferring multiple words, naturally, you cannot finish execution in one cycle. Multiple cycle will be required because you are loading or storing multiple memory words, right. So, this is where the things are slightly deviating from the pure RISC concept, but this is a very powerful instruction. So, in many application you may want to use it. You see, here one variation of this instruction is LDMIA. Well, there is another version LDMIB. Well, I will see the difference, I will show you. This A and B actually stands for, B is before, A stands for after. Means A is actually the acronym for after, B is the acronym for before. So, let us see how these instructions are specified. Here normally a load register, there are two operands, but here what I am saying, this first one is R 1. So, it is assumed that the first operand is containing the memory address, it is that register indirect thing. So, here we are not giving that square bracket, that is implied. And in the second operand within curly bracket, we are specifying a set of registers. Now, there are many ways we can specify, if the registers are consecutive in number, we can also write like this R2 dash R5. This means R2, R3, R4, R5, all 4, or otherwise you can separate by comma R3, R5, R6, which means this R1 contains the address of a memory location, you load the content of that memory location into R3, then load the next word, that means R1 plus 4, add 4 to the address, load into R5, R1 plus 8, you add 4 again, load it into R6. This A means you first load and then after that increase the address. There is another variation I said LDMIB before. Before means you first increase it by 4 and then load, which means if I give LDM IB instead of this, then the data will be loaded from memory addresses corresponding to R1 plus 4, R1 plus 8 and R1 plus 12, because first we are increasing it by 4 and then we are loading, right? Okay. And in the list of destination registers, we can use any of the 16 registers as we choose. And in addition to this B and A, we can also use this I and D option. You see here, this I has been used. I stands for increment, the addresses are getting incremented. I can also give D. If I give D, then the load and store will be happening in the reverse order, addresses will get decremented by 4. Okay? So, these all options are available. So, let us see some examples here. The first example I am showing here is store memory location increment after. So, here this R9, here I am giving this exclamation sign means this R9 will get incremented, auto indexing, auto increment. So, let us see what happens. Let us assume R9 initially points here. This is memory location, these are the memory addresses I am showing. Let us assume R9 is pointing here to address 100C. So, because it is after R0, R1, R2 store, so the value of R0 will get stored here, then address will be incremented, it will be just increased C plus 4, then R1 will be stored here, so again it will increase by 4. Then R5 will be stored here. Now, because of use this exclamation sign, this R9 will get incremented again and the final value of R9 will be this 1018. So, it will point to the next location after all these 3 store operations are done, right. Now, if instead if I give STM IB before, I increment before and then I store, then you see if R9 was here, nothing is getting stored here. First I increase the address, then I store, again I increase and store, then I increase and store, and then finally I update R9 as whatever was there plus 12, right. And let us look at some example for decrement. If it is STM decrement after, then the memory will go in the reverse direction, the address will get decremented. R9 first, you see. So, R9 was here, R0, R1, R5. So, it will get in the reverse order in this way and the final value of R9 will be here. And similarly, before, so this first one will be skipped, then decrement. So, first you decrement and then you store, decrement, store, decrement, store. So, for the decrement option, you note the values are getting stored in the reverse order. The rightmost one are getting stored first, the leftmost one are getting stored last. So, these are the various options and this already I have mentioned what are the meaning of this increment after, increment before, decrement after and decrement before. Okay? So, these flexible instruction set options are available in ARM. Now, one interesting thing is that there is no stack in ARM architecture, which is so much popular in other contemporary architectures. Of course, you can as a user or as a programmer, you can maintain a software stack, but there are no explicit push pop instructions, which are normally a part of the instruction set of conventional computer architectures, right. So, LDM and STM instructions can be used to implement stack, we shall see some examples later. Okay. Let us take one example of copying a block of memory locations, copy a block of 128 memory locations. Suppose I have an application wherein memory I have a block of consecutive 128 bytes. Okay. Let us say I want to transfer this entire block into some other memory location. Let us say here, I want to transfer it here. Now, using single register moves, what I can do? I can write a loop. So, I initialize some register with the starting address and I do it 128 times, read one, load one number from the initial block, store it here, load the next number, store it in the next location, load the third number, store it in the third location, and I check whether 128 number of data have been transferred. Now, here I will have to loop for 128 times. So, 128 times the entire loop will be executed. But when I use this kind of multiple register transfer instruction, let us say I have 8 registers at my disposal. So, if I load 8 registers together, store 8 registers at one time, that means I am transferring 8 bytes in one go. In terms of the loop, how many times I have to loop in that case? Only 16 times. 16 into 8 is 128. So, the number of instructions being executed in ARM will be drastically less. This will also reduce the overall execution time, because every instruction execution has its own overhead. So, if you transfer multiple memory location in one memory, as part of one single instruction, then the total number of clock cycles will be needing will be less, right. So, let us see how the program will look like here. Let us assume that R9 contains the address of the source, that means R9 contains the address of this memory location. R10 contains the address of the destination, that means this one, this is R10. And R11 is the address of the end of the source, that means R11 contains the last address of the source. So, I can write a program like this, a simple program. It checks, first I am doing LDM IA, this R9 is already initialized. You can see I am transferring 8 registers, loading 8 registers R0 to R7. With address from R9. So, the first 8 words will be transferred, and because I am using this auto indexing mode, this R9 will automatically get incremented by 8 into 4 32, okay. So, that next time it will be pointing to the next set of numbers, and we are doing a store with R10 same way. This is also auto indexing. So, R10 will also get incremented by 32. And these 8 registers we are storing one by one in this single instruction. Then you are comparing whether R9 has reached R11 or not. Well, if it has reached R11, it means we are done. Otherwise, branch if not equal, we repeat this loop. We repeat this loop how many times? We are transferring 8 data at a time. So, this will be 16 times, right. So, this will be much faster, because total, you see, because it is 16 times, so total number of instructions executing will be 16 instructions. But in the earlier case, if you are using single instruction load and store, your loop would go for 128 times. So, it would be, just you can imagine, here only 16 times, so it will be 128 into 4, it would be 512 instructions, but in comparison, you are here only requiring 64 instructions to be executed, right. So, it is a big gain you are getting. So, lastly, one thing we want to discuss, there is a concept called memory mapped IO, which is prevalent in many computer systems, microcontrollers, in particular in ARM also. So, the basic idea behind memory mapped IO is this. Normally, whenever some data are accessed, data memory address is generated by the microcontroller, the processor. There is a decoder which decodes this address and it selects the corresponding memory location. Normally, the data memory is accessed. But in memory mapped I/O, what we are saying in addition is that the input output, which are typically called I/O ports, the I/O ports are also regarded as memory locations. Suppose, let us take an example, suppose there are 64 I/O ports. So, we are assuming that there are 64 memory locations also here. So, the same decoder, depending on the address you are giving, will be selecting either one of the data memory addresses or one of these I/O ports. So, this I/O ports or I/O devices are treated as memory locations. This is the basic concept behind memory mapped I/O. There are no separate instructions for doing input and output. So, the basic thing as I mentioned, there are no separate instructions for input and output, which is there for some of the conventional processors, like let us say for those of you who are familiar with let us say the 8051 microcontroller or the 8085 microprocessor, there you will find in and out instructions which are meant primarily for input and output I/O. Okay. The I/O ports are treated as data memory location, where each of them will be having a unique address. So, when you want to read some data from an input device, you will be using load instruction. When you want to write some data into an output device, you will be using store instruction. That is how ARM handles it. So, this provides some added flexibility, because there are so many flexibilities the instruction set offers when you are accessing memory locations. Now, if you treat your I/O devices also as memory locations, then even when accessing the I/O devices, the same kind of flexibility you can utilize. Okay? Fine. So, with this we come to the end of this lecture. In the next lecture, we shall be talking something about the control flow instructions that are available in the ARM instruction set. Thank you.